right, welcome everyone to Neon Jaffa. Sorry you can't all be here, but under our current circumstances, we thought we would share a bit of an Easter devotion with you all so that you could join with us over this Easter period. So we're going to read mostly from the Bible today and share what Easter is all about and what that looks like and what that means to us today. So I'm going to start by reading from Matthew. We're going to start from where Jesus had already been arrested and go on from there. So he was arrested in the garden, and the soldiers and those that were there that arrested him brought him to the Sanhedrin, or Caiaphas, the highest of all the high priests. So I'm going to read from Matthew 26, verse 57 through, and then we'll jump across through a few different verses. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, where the teachers of the law and the elders had assembled. Down to 59. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for false evidence against Jesus so that they could put him to death, but they did not find any, though many false witnesses came forward. Then we're going to jump over to verse 65. Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has spoken blasphemy. Why do we need any more witnesses? Look now, you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think?" Speaking to all the other high priests, he is worthy of death, they answered. Then they spit in his face and struck him with their fists. Others slapped him and said, "Prophesy to us, Christ. Who hit you?" All right, then we're going to jump over a little bit further. Still, we're now in Matthew 27, and we're going to go down to verse 13, where Jesus is before Pilate, the regional king, I guess. And verse 11 says, "Meanwhile, Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, 'Are you the king of the Jews?' 'Yes, it is as you say,' Jesus replied." Now, Jesus hadn't answered that question before when he was with Caiaphas and the high priest, but now he answers that question before Pilate. And then we're going to jump down a little bit to verse 22, because Pilate had asked him a whole pile of questions and didn't get a lot of response from Jesus, so turned it back to the priests and the Pharisees as to what Pilate should do with Jesus. So verse 22 says, "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called Christ?" Pilate asked the crowd, which was mostly the Pharisees. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "Let his blood be on us and on our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but he had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. Now, I'm just going to take a little side note here and talk about what that means when it says he was flogged. In my NIV study Bible, it says down here, "Floggings in Roman times were so brutal that sometimes the victims died before crucifixion." And if I jump over a little bit further in my Bible into Mark, another reference talks about the flogging. "The Romans used a whip made of several strips of leather, into which were embedded pieces of bone and lead. The Jews limited the number of strips to a maximum of 40, but no such limitation was recognized by the Romans, and the victims of Roman floggings often did not survive." So a whip filled with pieces of bone and lead. All right, we're still in Matthew 27. We're down at verse 27 now, where the soldiers mocked Jesus after he was flogged. "The governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium," or his special place, special room in his palace, "and gathered the whole company of soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him." Scarlet is this really red color. "Put a scarlet robe on him and then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on his head." The crown of thorns would have looked something like this, made out of the local briars and brambles and thickets of things, a little bit like what we probably consider our box thorn today, and put that on his head, the symbolism of the king. They put the crown of thorns and set it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand and knelt in front of him and mocked him. "Hail, King of the Jews," they said. They spit on him and took the staff and struck him on the head again and again. After they had mocked him, they took off his robe and put on his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. They came to a place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. There they offered Jesus wine to drink, mixed it with gall, gall was a natural sort of a painkiller that they often used to give to people who were going to be crucified to reduce the pain. They offered Jesus wine to drink mixed with gall, but after tasting it, he refused to drink it. They had crucified him. They divided up his clothes by casting lots. And sitting down, they kept watch over him there. Above his head, they placed a written charge against him. "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Two robbers were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left, and one on the left of him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." Challenging him to save himself. Then we're going to go a little bit further along. Now we're still in Matthew 27, down to verse 45. "From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over the land." So in those days, they measured the hours from sunup. So the sixth hour to the ninth hour would have been from about midday till 3 p.m. in the afternoon. Darkness came over the land. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, if I can say this all right, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Down a little bit further, down to verse 50. "And when Jesus had cried out again in a loud voice, he gave up his spirit. At that moment, the curtain in the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. The earth shook and the rocks split. The tombs broke open and the bodies of many holy people who had died were raised to life. They came out of the tombs, and after Jesus' resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many people. When the centurion and those who were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, 'Surely he was the Son of God.'" Even they believed at that point. Moving down a little bit further, still in Matthew 27, we're down to verse 59, where Joseph of Arimathea comes along to take Jesus' body. "Joseph took the body, wrapped it in clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance of the tomb and went away." Verse 62. "The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. 'Sir,' they said, 'we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, after 3 days I will rise again. So give the order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he had been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first.'" So they were worried about the disciples stealing his body and making it up. "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. Matthew 28, continuing on at verse 1. "After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men." The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" Jumping down a little bit, continuing on. "So the women hurried away from the tomb, and afraid yet filled with joy, and ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly, Jesus met them. 'Greetings,' he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me.'" So jumping down to the last little bit in Matthew 28, verse 16 now. And this bit's titled The Great Commission, which we all have probably heard a bit about. "Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountains where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you to the very end of the age.'" So that's the basics of the Easter story and what we remember at Easter time. But we want to think about, what does that mean for us today? And what does that look like? The cross is empty and so is the tomb. Jesus is alive. He's won victory over sin and death. No other truth in history has the ability to change our lives and affect our future like this. Yet so many people still choose to reject Christ's sacrifice and love. He offers us a choice today. It's the best decision you would ever make, to accept what Jesus has offered. Christ's death on the cross and the power of his resurrection offers us a few things that we can learn from and use today. It provides a bridge, a way to God. It gives us an opportunity to have a personal relationship with him, with the very God who loves us and made us. Without the cross, there is no way to cross over to the other side in relationship with him. Jesus spoke in John 14, verse 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The cross and the resurrection also offers us forgiveness of sin. Through the price that Jesus paid on the cross, we have the chance to be forgiven of our sin. He took our sin and our shame upon his very shoulders. He took the pain on our behalf so we wouldn't have to suffer. That's how much he loved us. It provides freedom to all those who believe. It provides freedom from the shackles of sin, freedom from the shame, freedom from fear, freedom from worry, freedom from hopelessness, freedom from despair, freedom from addiction, freedom from guilt, freedom from darkness and eternal separation from God. It provides new life. We are not only forgiven and set free, but we have a whole new life and destiny through Christ. We are changed from the inside out. He renews our minds. He changes our hearts and desires. He gives us fresh purpose for every day. It provides power to us to live with today and to use. When Jesus died on the cross and was buried, it didn't stop there. We just read the Great Commission. The final picture of all that the cross provides lies in the powerful resurrection. He won. He didn't stay dead. He didn't stay in the tomb. His power broke through, and that same power is alive with us today. As believers, God gives us the power of the Holy Spirit, living and moving through each one of us today. We have with us everywhere we go. Inspires us and drives us to be everything God has challenged us and called us to be. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 57 says this, "But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Jesus took the suffering and the pain. He died on the cross, but conquered death and came back to life. But he gives us that victory through his sacrifice and death. We want to remember that this Easter and think about what that means for us in our lives today, what that looks like, and how we can live a life that honors Jesus' sacrifice all those years ago. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for your great gift of love and sacrifice so that we can live free. Thank you for the power of the cross and the resurrection. We ask that the truth of it all sink deeply into our hearts and minds and change us forever. Fill us fresh with your Spirit today. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks for watching. If you were challenged or if you have any questions or queries or you want to talk more with anybody about the Easter story and Jesus' death on the cross and resurrection, talk to somebody. Talk to your parents, talk to your family, talk to somebody that you have a relationship with, or contact us through our social media, Facebook, or those platforms, or contact the church here, contact one of us leaders, Neon Jaffa leaders, and we can have a chat about this. But we really want you to step into the challenges that the cross and the resurrection leave us with today and live that life worthy of Jesus' sacrifice. Thanks for watching. See you all soon.